Right, let's answer some of these Q&A questions for you guys. You put in the affiliated group. First, let's have Shannon's. You're curious to know what our plans are for international outreach in the future. Well, America, that's something we've really got to attack, something we've got to get into. I mean, we're having the same issue getting into America. Well, I think American organisations are having getting into the UK. Seems to be the place where people live, they prefer to join an organisation that's based in their own country. I mean, we are getting a bigger American representative base, but America is such a big country, we're going to need many reps all over it. And what we want them to do is their representative area will be their chapter. So they take the philosophy over there, they own it, they run it. So it cuts us UK side really out of it. It'll be American based, run by the representatives. Claire's just currently putting a list together about who's in the Gateway group, where they're from. And what we want the American representatives to do is engage with these members, get talking to them, pull them into the organisation so we can try and get a stronger American footing. It's a work in progress, but we will get there in the end. It's something we really need to look at. Next question, Claire and John, so I can basically answer your two together. Claire brought up a question about how many people realise they already use a 90-10 concept, and John was, how does S-theory fit in with other beliefs? Well, as much as we should already know about the 90-10 concept, it's an alternating fraction between a thought process, 90% being your daily pragmatic living, 10% being subjective ventures. But that all goes down to your individual mindsets. I mean, me personally, I'm a strong 90%, 10%, even 95%, 5% thinking. I rarely go into subjectivity. It's not something that I need to pragmatically advance my life. But then there's some of you that might like looking into the occult, looking into all things. When your fraction would be 70%, 30%, or what knows, here knows. It's the irrational part. I mean, we all have occurrences that might not be able to answer straight away. Can be took for life's issues as well. We could have issues that we can't look at now, put it to one side, come back to it later. But the main process of a 90-10% thinking is to separate the rational and the irrational. Now, that lower percentage of the subjectivity, that's yours to own. That part doesn't even require talking about, because frankly, if we spoke about what we did in the 10% of the time, we'd sound nuts, we'd sound crazy to people. So unless we can pragmatically use what's in that 10% and filter it down the facets to the 90% or whatever percentage your pragmatic part is, it doesn't require discussion. And then I'm going to move into John's question then, because he was asking, how does S3 fit in with other beliefs? Well, the S-theory concept, that's a way of strengthening the system through subjective or objective means. I mean, if you use the 90-10% thinking concept, 10% is a storage for your rational events. S-theory is the pragmatic investigation. Now, according to our mindset, so if you're more of a scientist, you're not going to have a great subjective fraction. So when you're applying the S-theory concepts, you're going to be creating theories mostly from a scientific background, but not only science, because the S-theory, you have to look into psychology, philosophy, all other aspects to create a solid S-theory. Could we have a diagram here? Hang on. S-theory creates a model-dependent reality. Imagine that is a model-dependent reality. Now all these theories are circles on this brush, but as you keep bringing them, your question is, where are we, the species, originated from? So you've got a theory up here of where the humans have originated from, and you've looked at something else and you've got another theory which is down here that could not resonate with this theory. So you've got two separate theories of where we originated from. Now what the S-theory concept will do, it'll look for overlapping points. So without S-theory, if you were to get a theory here and a theory here, it could blow a hole in your whole system. It could make you change your path, change your belief system, change the way you look at things when it's not necessary, because all you need to do is apply S-theory, look for other sources, and you need to find a theory which links with this top one, links with this bottom one. So that theory will create a circle that way, and the two overlapping points would strengthen your model-dependent reality. There's a sin explanation, but it's the model-dependent reality that's the strong part of your system. The more theories from more different sources you can actually get into there gives what you're claiming more success. It validates it more, rather than finding all your information from one source, then throwing it out there at people, saying, this is what happened, this is how it looks, I can back it up with this one source. But then if someone who used S-theory had something that sounded a bit crazy, sent it out there and says, look, I've got this theory, but I can back it up with this, I can back it up with science, I can back it up with psychology, here are the overlapping points, this is linked into my model-dependent reality, which I've discovered, then you can actually debate and you won't sound crazy or mad like you can do if you're just bringing information from one source. So yesterday the concept said to look at all things strange, things weird, things scientific, psychological, occult. It's to mould it all together, strengthen your system, strengthen your reality, and give you theories about things you can't explain, and give it more credibility rather than just sending things out into the public that can only be explained from one angle. It gives a lot deeper than that, the S-theory does. So it's explained in the book, but to cover them two questions, that's really the usage of a 90-10 combined with the S-theory, and it filters from one side to the other. As the as we know, the 90%, 10% concepts in the third side, which can be a bit biased, because depending on the original fraction, they're going more subjective, more scientific. That's which way the scales are tipped when you start looking at things. Like, I won't really look at things from a subjective, axiomated viewpoint, because I'm more of a scientist into the physics, astronomy, so I'll be looking for the facts. Where with the S-theory, I could have a look at the subjective and the objective reasoning, scientific, psychological, philosophical. I can get a theory from all three, strengthen the system. I mean, if I had something from a subjective experience which worked and created a theory from something I had from an objective experience, without S-theory, that could blow a massive anomaly in my system. And so what the S-theory does, instead of having to replace the system, you just change the theory. The overlapping points fills in the holes in the system, so you'll never change the system, you will always only be a rational Satanist. And this also prevents that strange saying you get when you get these people saying they want to be dark pagan Satanists and all that, and because they found something else that resonates with them. With S-theory, you just take it into S-theory, create the theory, create the model-dependent reality, filter it through to the third side of the 90-10% thinking, alter your fraction, shift your fraction accordingly, and you're still a rational Satanist. You don't need some ludicrous 10-word title to explain your system. That was a bit long-winded, but I hope that's answered your question, to be fair. And we've got another one I want to hit here. Trisha, cracking question. The people in the occult, we love to learn him, but is it important to have some in-depth knowledge on the occult? No. If you're not interested in the occult, it doesn't mean you can't be a Satanist. You can have the core values of a Satanist and not even look at any occult literature whatsoever. If it doesn't interest you, then you have no need to. Let's say, I've said before, people say Satan requires study. I say Satan requires you to be yourself. All you need is that S-type personality. If you've got that, when you're a Satanist, you don't need to look into something you're not interested in. That'd be like me wanting to look into a cookery book when I've got no interest in cooking. I can't cook, so that ain't gonna bother me though. So yesterday said you don't need the occult, and that's it. If you don't like it, you don't have to have it. Let's just touch on Rob's at the end. Various groups of Satanists are made, not born. Do you think it's deep down? It could be, like we said, it's people who have the S-type personality, it all depends what time in their life that it's activated, that it's discovered. We've all got it inside us, but sometimes it might take an event to give us that viewpoint that's going to spark the thought saying, hang on a minute, I look at life a bit different here, so what am I? It happens to us all. It's probably good to say, through the early years, it's the environment you're brought up in can trigger it. We don't know. I mean, I've always been looking at things different. I mean, that's probably due down to my mother as well, because you might not say that my mother's a closet Satanist, because it's just as bad as me. But I mean, I had my childhood ruined at an early age because I was told that Santa Claus didn't exist, probably about the age of 5. So, you know, I've always been out there discovering things for what they are. But for other people, it might not be till the late teens or even in the 20s or 30s that they actually discover who they actually are. So, that's the answer to that, John. It's like suppression through whatever direction life takes. I mean, if they've been subjected to religion at a young age, it might take to get that bit of freedom in the teenage years, that little bit of rebellion attitude, to want to become the adversary, to become the voice of reason, to go against the status quo, what they're used to. So it might take that up, that suppressed upbringing, to activate the S-type personality. But it's in there. It's like, it's one of them, if you haven't got the S-type personality, and no matter how much study or worship or God knows what you want to read, is going to bring it to you. You've either got it or you've not. Just when it's activated is the question. So there's the answer to that question. I don't think there's any more there I'm going to touch on there. So I hope that answers your questions anyhow. So I plan on doing another one of these, if I can get a few more questions in, so I can get some practice in these videos, because a bit rusty on these. So good night.